I'm Wade Price, and that which I cannot crush with words, I will crush with the tanks of the Imperial Guard. Today's guest on VoxCast is Citadel Miniatures designer Tom Walton.
Hey, Tom.
Hello.
Welcome to VoxCast.
Thank you for having me, Wade.
Well, this has been a long time in the coming, I think. You've been an ideal guest. I identified from a little while ago, you turned up early, you turned up all hydrated and everything. You don't have jangly stuff on your wrists to bang the tables.
I'm trying my best for you, Wade.
So you're here in your capacity as Citadel Miniatures designer.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, I hope so.
Because you've been doing that for quite a while, right?
I have. I've been in the business for about 13 years now, and the vast majority of that has been as a miniatures designer.
Excellent. So in typical VoxCast fashion, we'd like you to outline your origin story for us, please. So how did you first find out about Games Workshop and 40K?
I had all the board games and all the fighting fantasy novels and stuff like that. I played D&D with my family and stuff like that, but... I guess it was the fighting fantasy books that kind of nudged me towards the Games Workshop end of things.
That was very much my origin story as well, because I used to read those books, and Steve Jackson and Ian Livingstone co-founded the wildly successful Games Workshop
show. Exactly.
I had to go and find what a Games Workshop was. And
Did they have adverts for that stuff in there? Or
I think it was just the frontispiece, like the very first page of every book, just let you know, Steve Jackson and Ian Livingstone, they did Games Workshop, you know.
That's right.
And then I moved off of the books and into Games Workshop stores, I think, and never looked back.
I think it was quite a natural and common thing at the time, wasn't it? You started off with the fighting fantasy books, and then as your powers grew, you moved on to the more hardcore
end of things.
You leveled up, yeah. But I had all the hero quests and advanced hero quests and all of those sorts of things as well.
Hero quest was great. Yeah. Like, we've mentioned hero quest a lot on there, but advanced hero quest, again, like leveling up, as the name suggests, it was a little more advanced than hero quest.
It was, and even the miniatures were a little bit more advanced as well. So I think that's when I first started really like noticing the miniature design and... they weren't just counters anymore. They were little artistic sculptures in their own rights and stuff like that. So, yeah, that's what first started attracting me to the Games Workshop.
Cool. And do you remember what 40K Citadel miniatures you first interacted with?
I did. My first ever box was the second edition 40K box, which I played with my brother. And I had the Orcs and he had the Space Marines. And we... battled it out, mostly making up a lot of the rules as we went along, or our own interpretations of the rules as we saw fit at the time. I was the older of the two, so it was usually rules based around how I could win.
Yeah, I think you're fine. It reads like this.
Yeah.
So you get to play with the cardboard orc dreadnought.
We did. And the hundreds and hundreds of Gretchen that you got there.
Little spiky helmets on them.
The little spiky helmets and the auto guns. Yeah. It was great. The box art was really striking as well. I remember that. And with that goes your first trips to the Games Workshop stores and things like that. My local was the Hull branch.
Okay.
And I became a very frequent visitor of that, especially when my parents realised they could drop us off with some paints and some tape measures and stuff like that. And then we could just entertain ourselves and... ask them for more stuff.
Those are the days, aren't they? Good times. So you picked the Orcs, and it sounds like you had, as the older brother, you had the choice of which of the forces, and you gravitated towards the Orcs.
I did. I wanted to be the baddies.
Okay.
I wanted to be the baddies. And after I collected not a massive, but a bigger Orc army, I'd branched off into Chaos after that. And they were the first proper army that I had. Really enjoyed just being the bad guy, and I remember the guy at the whole branch being very into the background of Chaos and would tell me things that were going on and set off things in my imagination of just how dark and brutal it was, which is is a unique selling point for a lot of Warhammer stuff.
That second edition Chaos Codex, remember that big spread of John Blanche?
Like, yes.
John Blanche drew some conversions you could do and then annotated how you could make them, and that was like a real step change, I think, for that book, because you saw the wonderful miniatures and you thought, but even in the showcase section that had like little Chaos Star asterisks saying, that's a conversion. That really excited me, like being able to flick through. I've been a big fan of Chaos since I got into it as well.
Well, I did a lot of conversions and stuff like that, not all successfully. I would have Chaos Terminators riding on beasts and stuff like that, and it looked silly, but in my head it was, I was being John Blanche, I was doing all of those things, and it was I kind of really liked getting, say, a Land Raider at the time, and then putting lots of stuff on it, and put little Nurglings dotted around it, and how, you know, making it into a Nurgle version and things like that. And I really like that side of messing around with something to make it your own.
Yeah. Yeah. So how long were you doing this until you decided, I could do this professionally?
Well, I did fall out of it for a long time. It just sort of, you know, you grow up, you change, your interests drift into certain areas and back again.
Yep.
But it wasn't until I started university that it really started to get back into it again. Okay. I had lots of housemates and course mates and stuff like that who were into it. I was like, oh, Games Workshop. I used to really like that stuff. Saw the advances that were made within the miniatures themselves and the games and the video games and all of the stuff that had come up around it, and just got really excited about it again. And through my university, I managed to get a placement here at Games Workshop.
Sweet. Yeah. And what was it you were doing at university?
So I was doing, I did a year of physics to start off with, which I didn't continue. I changed on to product design and manufacturing engineering, which was an engineering course degree.
Mm-hmm.
And I much prefer the more hands-on approach to designing and making things then. And I really like the rapid prototyping, 3D scanning mm-hmm. area of things. There are exciting new technologies that were just coming around at the time. Digital design wasn't really, it was a thing for like animation and films and video game and stuff like that, but people weren't designing stuff on computers that made it out into manufacture yet. So the placement here was for a rapid prototyping and 3D scanning engineer, and I thought, wow, not only is it the most exciting bit of the course that I'm doing, but it's also at Games Workshop, which I had a history with as well. So I just had to go for it, really.
Do you know what the kind of traditional expectation of someone on your degree course would have been?
A lot of them went into sort of like automotive industries and aeronautics and stuff like that, and I think some of them just ended up drifting off into graphic design, industrial design, all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. All my friends from uni ended up into those sorts of things. So I was really happy to just be able to come into something that I loved beforehand. And it was really weird because when I started university, that job didn't even exist. I wasn't a career path that I knew was like, oh, when you grow up, you can be a rapid manufacturing engineer or something. That wasn't really something that had ever existed or even existed in my wildest imaginings. So yeah, it was just great to be able to like do something that was not only within my interest of what I was studying, but also with the subject matter of something that I was already in love with. So yeah, that was great.
Do you remember what the first things you worked on when you joined Games Workshop were?
Yeah, so the first things were I was working in a team, and we had this new bit of software that involved a haptic arm, which is like a 3D stylus that we use for moving clay around on screen. And that had just come out, and we were playing with that to try and see how we could use it as a way to develop so that the traditional sculptors could use it as a new method for sculpting digitally. So we started off doing a lot of reverse engineering stuff. We took Forge World kits, such as the Piranha and the Valkyrie and things like that, and we took the resins of them, scanned them, and then cleaned them up and tried to make them into plastics.
Okay. And was it vehicles rather than like busts or miniatures?
Yeah, it was vehicles at the time that was the main focus of what we were doing, because we could use the CAD programs as well as this new software that we had to sort of recreate the original Forge World models, but as plastic kits and stuff like that. And that was a really exciting time to just be like, you're inside the machine, you're inside the dream factory, so to speak. And it was great. It was real great eye opener. I was seeing lots of the designers coming down and helping out. Ali Morrison, Colin Grayson, and Alex Hedstrom, and people like that were coming down to try all these new bits of software and new techniques and things like that. And I'd only ever seen them in White Dwarfs, and I'd seen their models and things like that. And to see how they worked and see how they lent their sort of creative talents into the world of technology and stuff like that was great to just see that kind of, you know, synergy of two different styles coming together. It was, really exciting times.
Yeah, I can imagine. We talked to a few of those people on VoxCast and Stormcast. Certainly talked to Ali Morrison for Stormcast, and he was reflecting on like his 30 plus years as a Citadel miniatures designer. He's seen everything. And I chatted to you a little while ago about how I'd seen in a White Dwarf. I've got a White Dwarf on my shelf I was looking through from 1991, and there was a job advert in the opening pages of White Dwarf saying they were looking for a straightforward, as you were, normal Citadel miniatures designer, someone to make miniature figurines according to the understanding of sculpting models in 1991, and also a straight line figure designer who had experience of making vehicles. And it struck me that even nearly 30 years ago, 20 years ago, there's a clear difference as far as Games Workshop saw it, in the kind of skill set to make miniature figurines of people and miniature vehicles. And talking to Ali about like the changes in digital design and production, I imagine, as you were saying, you're working on Forge World stuff, looking at cracking the vehicle kits, first of all. Do you know how the Forge World vehicles had been made originally, the first time around, if they hadn't been made with clever computers?
Yeah, I think everything was made with like plasticard and wood putty and things like that back in the day. Yeah. So vehicles were a different discipline, but they were also, because they were much bigger, they needed different ways of being able to manufacture and make them and design them and things like that as well. So, yeah, they were the best things to start off doing this new digital scheme because they were so big. So, for example, we used to, when they used to make things traditionally, sculpt them, they'd make three ups, which are three times bigger kits of, you know, a miniature that you might see. But when you're doing that with a vehicle, a three times up of, they've got the original copy of the Eldar Falcon, for example, and it's like this huge, looks like a shield or something like that. It's gigantic, and so the digital design was an excellent way of, you know, making that more plausible.
Yeah. So there was never a three up made of the Stomper or the Shadow Sword?
No, the Stomper came along. And the Shadow Sword came along later on when we were doing the digital stuff. So, yeah, they were saved from having that. But, yeah, I do remember seeing, like, three-ups of some of the other vehicles, and they were huge. Mm. They were unwieldy. Jez Gooder was telling me about how he got the Falcon. He had to have it under his arm and, you know, sand it down, plane it down to get it to a smooth surface and stuff like that. And it was just incredibly time-consuming and just unwieldy. So that was the first area that we sort of looked at in terms of updating, modernizing into a better way of doing things. But yeah, back in the day, they did have... It was two separate disciplines of straight-line design and organic design, they called it. And with the advent of digital technologies and stuff like that, we started blurring the lines a little bit more. Although I have spent the majority of my time doing vehicles and robots and... because they were better to be done digitally. That's sort of my area that I ended up getting into. It wasn't like, I'm going to join and be a straight line designer or whatever. But it did play into my engineering background and the software that I used and the skills that I already had from university leading up to here. So, yeah, it was a natural fit. It was accidentally a completely natural fit to what I was doing anyway.
Did your physics year help, or your interest or whatever you knew about physics, has that helped you making fantastical monstrous devices?
I think so. I think that grounding of what's it called, where you a suspension of disbelief is a big thing with our models, and we do make wacky zany stuff. We make wizards and space ninjas and all sorts of crazy contraptions and stuff like that, but I think something that really helps you immerse into the world that we've created is this just an aspect of realism in there. And I think a lot of the stuff that I learned from physics helped the theory, especially of things that were going on in space and special relativity and all of the edge case weird space stuff that you hear about. I think really helps you sort of get yourself into the universe and add that just little edge of plausibility into the things that you're designing. So
So not to be discounted, if someone's looking to maybe become a Citadel Miniatures designer, if they've got a bit of a grounding or a background in sciences, certainly not a hardship at all.
Yeah, I think Robin was a physicist as well.
And I dare say enough hobbyists out there in the world share those interests as well. So if there are little nods to real world things or scientific things, there'll be plenty of people out there who do pick up on those and maybe come and... I saw that Easter egg, they might come and let you know at Warhammer Fest or something like that. That's got to be
absolutely. It used to be the games days and stuff like that. That stuff would really come across, but now with the social media and things like that, I can definitely say that, you know, a lot of people in the same circles relate to the same thing. So that's it's a really positive thing.
So would it be fair to say now there's no differentiation between designers who work on miniature figurines and designers who work on vehicles. You're all Citadel Miniatures designers. You could work on any project depending on what you're asked to do, or is it?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it is now. It's the lines have very much blurred. I tend to still do quite big kits and stuff like that, which tend to be vehicles and things like that, because that's where my sort of, that's where I've been doing most of my effort, put most of my effort in learning. So I'm still doing that sort of stuff, but the more organic side of stuff is coming through more and more every year, really.
Cool.
And the other way around as well. A lot of people who've maybe only made figures before are having their go at doing vehicles and things like that as well. So it's not so much that hard line between straight edge designers and organic designers now. Mm. It's more of a, everyone does a bit of everything. Yeah. You know?
Yeah. What's the most organic thing that you've worked on then?
Oh, I don't know. I guess that might have been, I mean, early on, my second project was the Tyranid Trigon.
Yeah.
Which I worked on with Ali, of course. And that was a real baptism of fire, because all of the software that I used at the time was quite straight line design. And I suddenly was doing all of these flowing curves and scales and organic gribbly bits and stuff like that. So that was really good to be able to sort of take what you know and twist it to what it had to be made.
Yeah.
But it was really good. I learned a load of stuff through that. And I'm really proud of the outcome of it as well.
That was an amazing kit, and I remember Ali working on the screen over various weekends and evenings in the studios as he was kind of getting to grips with the new technology as well, I guess. But I remember that Trigon kit did enormously well. That was like far better than the Codex. I think people were looking at the time going, we saw like four times as many Trigons as there are people who bought books in places that people have never even bought the books. And I think that made people realize delighting in the miniatures is as big a part of the hobby as necessarily collecting an army to play a game. I think a lot of people just bought the Trigons and went, that thing's amazing. I don't even necessarily know what it belongs to. I don't even want an army of it. I think a lot of people saw it as a big kind of alien dragon with no wings or whatever they might see it as. Beautiful miniatures. That's a great thing to be working on. And
yeah, I feel I've been very fortunate falling into the sort of big things category because I think a lot of people, that's maybe their centerpiece or their, oh well, I don't collect this army, but I would get that one because it's like a centerpiece thing, or it's a if I'm going to get one of something, it's going to be the big one. I'm very fortunate because I think people lavish a lot more attention onto those sorts of things, and they really get all the details that you've put in there. I mean, we do lavish a lot of attention on making sure that the details of kits really come through, and you know, the plausibility of how the engines work, how the science and how the, you know, engineering of everything works as well. And if we were just doing something for, say, a computer game or an animation, it might be on screen for a few seconds and then it's gone. But with Games Workshop kits, people are there. They've got their, you know, magnifying glasses on, and they're looking at that detail and spending a long time perusing the work that you've done. So it's really great to see that all that effort that you've put into detailing and putting narrative stuff in there, it really pays off, because people feel very attached to the things that they do. And I feel really glad to be able to do these big things that people have spent all this time assembling and painting and getting to know.
And you've said there's no hiding, like you can't just kind of get to the deadline, move on, I'll never have to look at the Rhino chassis ever again or something like that, because not only will there be people playing with these for a long time to come, but you'll probably have to work on, or someone you work with might have to work on, some derivation further down the line or something else that keys off a kit that you worked on. So yeah, it's got to be here for the long term and perfect.
It's a blessing and a curse, really, because the longevity of these things is really long. Like, we have stuff in the range that's been there for 20 years and things like that. And back then, people didn't know how long this was going to go on for, or like, oh, when someone invents digital design in 20 years and wants to go back and add something to it, let's make sure that we facilitate that. But now we do know those things, we have to plan for how something is going to look in 20, 30 years' time. Are people still going to be playing with this? Did I put the turret of this thing on a frame so that we could change it out for a different thing in the future if we want to make it into something else? Or are all the weapons cross-compatible, and are the sizes of turrets and sponsons and fittings the same as with other kits and kits that we might do in the future? So there's a lot of things to think about.
And is that all still on you as the designer of the kit?
Yeah, all that stuff originates and stays with us. So we... I don't think everybody understands, but the process does very much start with us. We start on concepting of ideas and mocking up of ideas, as well as the making of the final kits as well. So when we're thinking of the narrative behind the story we're trying to tell through the model, we're also thinking about the actual, you know, the engineering side of it as well, the fittings and how it's going to fit on the frame and how it's going to, how big it's going to be on the battlefield and stuff like that. And it's quite a lot of it is down to us to as individuals, but as a team and with our managers and with our senior design staff as well, just to make sure that that thing is right, because once it's done, it's going to be in the range for 20 years and we want to make sure that it stands the test of time.
I wanted to talk to you about the kind of the work that the miniatures design team has to do to communicate, as you say, what it is, the narrative of the pieces that you're working on, because you can't always rely on the fact that someone might get to read the background in a codex or read something on the website or White Dwarf. What you see is what you get with the miniature, and you have to be able to convey everything that's in your head without being able to talk to people about it. You must be able to do an awful lot of that non-verbal communication. And we've talked about the Imperial Knight with it's a big, wonderful looking beast, but it's heavy looking. It's not up straight and upright in a way that would make you think it might blow away in a stiff breeze. So do you have like a kind of checklist of how to convey the features of miniatures that you want to convey without telling people?
I don't know if it's a checklist. It's more of a sort of unspoken thing at this point, because we've been doing it for so long. And so when we start off on a kit, it's not always written down what it is. It's not always a known quantity that we're like, oh, this is a what's it, and then we're making it. Sometimes we have to come up with that, and there's no stories about it, and there's no background about it, and there's nothing else like that about it. So when we come to something like the Knights, Jez actually had a really good idea of what they were before we even started. He'd had spent years sort of developing this idea of what it was, but we had to get that stuff across, like you mentioned, non-verbally. So we have to spend a lot of time on making sure that, as you say, what it looks like, what it how it holds itself, its whole weight behind it, how the little things in it, the mechanics and the stories and that, everything about that works, just purely by a visual circumstances. So what we tend to do is we make a mock-up of what it is that we're making, and then we get that rapid prototype and have a look at it as what it will be like on the tabletop, and then we just make assessments of what that tells us based on what it looks like and nothing else.
Okay.
Because if you lean on that, like, oh, but people know what it is from this, then somebody from another country or someone who hasn't read the books or maybe doesn't live somewhere where it's been translated won't be able to get that across. You want to, and you're selling this off the back of looking at it and going, that's cool, rather than off the back of hearing about where it's cool. And then we want the design to lead that in sometimes. We make sure that its stance is telling us, it belies the weight behind how heavy it is. It's not going to be prancing around the battlefield or running or sprinting around. It's going to be really heavily and industrially moving around the battlefield there. And hundreds of other little tiny things that we put in there, sometimes to just fill it out for visual interest, to make sure that your eyes go to the focal point, to make sure that you include an in-world, world building experience from it. That's something that tells you about how it works, something that tells you about how you imagine it moving and things like that. And I think all of those sorts of things really immerse yourself in the world and help you to I think the best kits, you have your own version in your head of what they're doing. Like, you can imagine it. You see it and you imagine that, stomping around, killing everything indiscriminately, and the sounds and sights of what it's going to be like. Even just how it works within the universe as well. So we tend to put things like lots of rungs on areas where you can imagine servitors or tech priests climbing up around and, making reparations or refueling or things like that. And then we've got lifting lugs on some of the elements of the arms and legs and stuff. So you imagine when they're in a hangar and they're being reassembled or something, that these are the areas that are being lifted by these huge industrial machines and things like that. And they're just little things like a lifting lug can just in your head spark off a thought about how that thing was put together. And when you look at the fighting compartment from the side, you can see on the torso all the different sorts of pipes and stuff that go in there, but also a little outline of where the fighting compartment would be. And when I'm designing stuff like that, I'm thinking about, what is this thing I'm plugging into it? Well, this is a cable that looks this way because it's going to have, in my head, the, you know, electrical components that are going to be the, you know, optics for the knight, or this one here is going to be the thing that preserves the princept inside, or this one here is going to be for, you know, conveying fluid around the different elements of the knight as well. So yeah, and I can't tell someone that's what it is, but I'm hoping if I stick to that same design, if I make the pipes, if I make the designs look a certain way and keep that consistent throughout everything, that people will gradually piece together how that works.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There'll be some people, I guess, who just don't really mind, but there'll be some people who really do want to know, and they'll be very satisfied to see that's been worked out.
And like I said, the people's going to spend a lot of time looking at that very closely. So I want to reward someone for putting that extra thought into it as well. I don't want to someone to look at something that I've made and be like, why is that there? Oh, because it's cool. Yeah. It's nice that it's cool, but it's more important that you're imagining it working in within the universe, and you're, you know, you're do a little smile because you're like, oh, somebody's thought about that. And I think in Games Workshop, a lot of people do that. The writing and the game details and, you know, the rules and things like that are all done by people who just want to put that little bit of extra detail in, that little bit of extra, oh, someone's thought about this kind of feel to it.
So what form do your mock-ups take?
Different. They're different for every project. So sometimes we would maybe get like a 50, if it's something really big, it might get a 50% version of it done, or we might get four or five things done in with different silhouettes and different weapon options and different things like that, just to see what really resonates with us when we see it. Because sometimes the thing that sounds like the best idea might not look the best, or sometimes the thing that you think is too over the top and weird, you get out and you're like, no, that's fine, that's not, you know, that's absolutely fine. Or something you think is really over the top and weird and interesting comes out and you're just like, oh, that's not, for some reason, it's just not working in as a whole as much as I thought it would. So it's really good to get this sort of range of ideas out there so we can pick apart what we like and don't like about each one and make the best thing for the outcome.
Yeah. And do it using miniatures rather than words, written descriptions. And yes. Oh, it'll be like this. It'll be something like this. And having identified that you need to convey the idea with a finished miniature, I guess that has to start in your office with the people that you're working with and go, I've got a great idea. They want to see that great idea and how other people would interact with it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you can write down the coolest thing in the world, but if you can't represent that visually, then that doesn't translate as well as you'd hope. Mm. So, it's all about what it looks like and whether the actual model is conveying what we want, rather than like, oh, it looks really weak, but we'll just write up that it's really strong. That doesn't work. You have to get that across in maybe its pose or its silhouette or how it's armed and things like that. And the language we're using is visual design language, and making sure that stuff looks a specific way. So when you look at a Space Marine vehicle, it has to feel like a Space Marine vehicle, and we have lots of ways of just lots of little rules that sometimes are verbalized and sometimes are just carried on through looking back at what we've done. But like, for example, a lot of the Space Marine flyers are quite slab fronted. They're quite heavy and unaerodynamic, and Jez always told me the thing about Space Marine flyers is they're rocket powered fists. They're not, none of this, like, they don't have to be elegant or aerodynamic or anything like that. They're meant to be brutal. And just a little phrase like that can really set it off in your head of, like, what you're trying to achieve when you're designing something like that. And, I think, you know, you can put aside that, oh, but no, it wouldn't work in real life. It's not real life. It's a visual metaphor for, this thing wouldn't fly. It would if you put big enough rockets on it.
Yep.
Because that's more in universe how Space Marines work.
Yeah. And it's all in atmospheres of planets we've never been to 38,000 years in the future. It's very difficult for anyone to say that's definitively been stress tested and we know that it doesn't fly because it doesn't exist. So I trust that you've put the thought into it to make sure that it will work in the context of the galaxy and all of the other devices and war machines, because of the same thinking that informs the Space Marine vehicles and the Knights and the Astra Militarum vehicles goes into everything, then it should be very cohesive altogether, because nothing's going to look out of sorts with anything else. Even though they've got very different design aesthetics or design cues, they all feel like they belong in the same universe. You don't look at any factions from 40K and think, they'd never meet, would they? Even the Tau with their cleaner, more modern type of technology compared to some of the Imperium's technology, they certainly look like they belong on the battlefields of the 41st Millennium, getting blasted apart by Space Marines and explosive bolters.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And they we put the same amount of work and process into something like that than we would a Space Marine, because we love them equally, and because we want them to, we want the same feeling of like, oh well, so that's how it works. So when I was making the Ghost Keel with Matt Holland, we were trying to come up with ways of how we could convey the size and the how it worked and stuff like that. And that's how the cockpit that opens up came about, because it was just a great shorthand of being able to show somebody, show, don't tell, say. And we were trying to show people how these things work, the scale of the thing. How did somebody get, how did Tau get Firewarry, get in there and plug himself into all the machinery and make it work? And like I said before, it's just about sparking off someone's imagination of how this thing actually operates and works, and now just pulls you into the world a little bit more.
Yeah, I think we're seeing a bit of a resurgence in sort of dioramas and vignettes that people are making as a legitimate expression of the hobby. Kind of like faded away, I guess, at the end of the 90s, and there's a lot of armies, but now you see more and more of that. And thinking about you describing the loading lugs on the Knights, I'm sure there are people who've built dissembled Knights, or Knights in a stage of being assembled in a hangar somewhere, and people who want to model in that regard don't necessarily want to play a game with it. The building the model and telling a story with the model, I think that's what the dioramas give people the opportunity to do, to show some of those behind the scenes that you don't necessarily see on the tabletop, in the tabletop war game. So giving people the tools to do that, I think that's going to be well received as well, because there are kind of fine detail modelers, scale modelers out there, and when you see some of those features coming into detailed Citadel Miniatures kits, that gives people the tools they need to go and build that sort of stuff.
Yeah, that's a really exciting part of it, is just seeing what... So we give somebody this gift of a miniature and stuff like that, and I'm like, I have put a lot of thought into this, and seeing someone else and take it and run with it and put their own expression of what they see into it. It's just amazing, because there's not many areas just of anything. You go see a film and you can write a fanfic of it or something like that, but the miniature is the thing that people are putting all their time and effort into, and it's their creation as much as it is ours sometimes. It's very much about them putting their own perception of how the universe works, or what they like about a particular kit, or what they would do differently on a kit as well. And you just sometimes I see stuff and goes, wow, that is a really great idea. I mean, it's, and you see it all the time, and people seem to be getting better at it, and they seem to be sharing ideas. I mean, with social media and the community and stuff like that, people are just coming up with just all sorts of great concepts, and seeing something that you've made and that has sparked off an interest in someone else that they want to go out and be creative themselves. That's a great thing.
Yes,
like I said, there's not many areas of life where you can that a hobby or something you partake in is an active investment of your imagination and creativity, as well instead of just being something you consume. It's something that you engage with, and people are really passionate about that, and it's really great to be the spark for somebody else's imagination, as much as it is just going, this is it, this is my amazing thing, have it. It's, you know, that's finished, that's the best it'll be. We're going, here's this thing, run with it. And that's sure, a really exciting part of what we do, really.
The Imperial Knight, when that came out, we talked about that as a centerpiece model, and it would have been very easy to go, you can collect knights, you can have armies of knights, like armies of everything else, but to present that as an option for the people who do want to buy armies of knights, and they're out there and they're great, but also just to let people know, if you just want a knight, you can have a knight. It's fine. They're really cool. Here's loads of examples of just great one-off knights to have as the start of a collection, or the centerpiece of a collection. And I think that the examples, when people see the sorts of things that are possible in a creative modeling hobby, I think a bit like the advances in technology, until you know that something is possible, you're just kind of like, well, I'm very satisfied with everything that I know right now, because you don't know what else there is. But then when digital designing comes along, oh, you could make things like this, or seeing expressions of the sorts of things people do, making dioramas or scratch building stuff, converting stuff, once you see it, then you go, oh, I could do that. And then you get, I saw someone had made an Imperial Knight with a little cathedral on the top of it. So they'd taken some of the kind of Sigmarite mausoleum from the Age of Sigmar range and built that up, and then moss and lichen hanging over the top of it. And it looked phenomenal. And
yeah.
I can imagine there's other people who've done similar sorts of things, like meshing the idea of the old devotional titans with the 40k scale knights. Because that's a very creative hobby of making things on a bigger scale, I guess. There's a whole suite of Adeptus Titanicus titans that people can collect if they want smaller titans. But for something that big and impressive for the 40k scale, where most of the bits correspond to it, like converting knights seems to be like a legit hobby. And then Chaos Knights came along, and there'd already been people sticking spikes on their Imperial Knights quite happily. And then you came and showed them another way of looking at Chaos Knights, because that had a lot of the things you were talking about, like the asymmetry, the features that let you know what makes this Chaos Knight different from an Imperial Knight. And we touched on those talking about it on live, but that then shows people, if you want to make a Chaos Knight, it's a proper Chaos Knight. Do it like that.
Yeah, it's a guideline in a lot of ways. I mean, when so I worked on that with Del Stringer and Jess Goodwin, who designed the original Imperial Knight. So it was really good to go back and see everything we'd learned from what people enjoyed about the original Knight, and just feed that back into it. And it's about providing a framework without being too prescriptive of what that is. So if somebody, say, wanted to take it and just pull it towards one their favoured Chaos Power or era or something like that, it's not too much of a step. So it's, you're trying to balance it somewhere in the middle, and that's the same for a lot of designs as well. A lot of things that we do, we try to, there are some things that are like, this is a character, he looks exactly like that, this is our representation of it. And then there's some things that are like, this is the basis of some of things that we are going to be making. You know, do with it what you will. For example, of the Primaris stuff is it's quite stripped back detail wise, because the idea is when we go into the future, we have that space to go into and to make the elaborate ones and make the ones with, you know. We did quite a stripped back Redemptor Dreadnought, especially compared to like a Venerable Dreadnought or something like that. But then it allows somebody to, who likes the older stuff, to take this new one and be like, oh, well, what would a Venerable version of this look like? And we sort of giving that as a jump off point for people to do what they want with it and have fun and, you know, explore lots of different ideas and things.
I think hobbyists would rather stick cool stuff onto their models than have to kind of hack stuff that had been wonderfully designed by a Citadel miniature designer. I don't need that. I mean, you mentioned the Redemptor as well, that talking about how you have to know what the noises for things make are going to be like, because Black Library might do an audio drama that features it, and you need to know the locomotive properties of some of these things in case they appear in a huge video game that licensing have embarked upon, and then you definitely can't hide away from it. So you talked about the Redemptor Dreadnought having looked at the points of articulation and to make sure it can definitely walk, so that if it goes on a video, you'll see it walk.
Yeah, well, one of the things that we looked at with the original Dreadnought was it was just, as a static image, it was really cool. But then as soon as you start thinking about how it's actually going to walk, it doesn't have any knees. It's going to walk in quite a staccato fashion, which has its own charm and stuff like that. And people, God bless them, have animated them successfully. But when it came to redesigning it into the Redemptor, we actually made a full animation cycle to make sure that all of the legs would walk in a specific way of how we wanted to, and have the arms would have a range of movement. So if they were to have different weapons on in the future, they would still have the articulation to be able to use them and things like that. And yeah, it's all in mind of hearing those noises and seeing those sights of, like, imagining what that would look like if it was a cut scene or a bit from a film where a Redemptor smashes down a wall and then, you know, walks out through the debris, and then the, you know, the sarcophagus fronts open up and gets exchanged for a new one or something like that. It's all in our mind while we're designing things like that, so we can try and facilitate it for, yeah, what's it going to be look like in the future? What's it going to look like if it's in a video game? What's it going to look like in the stories and stuff like that? What's it going to be capable of when someone's writing a novel about it and things like that? So yeah, it's a lot to think about, really.
Do you get tapped up by other people around the business for your insights in, like, how do repulsors work and how do Redemptor Dreadnoughts work? Has anyone ever come to ask you, what sort of noise does a repulsor make?
Yeah, like that. Cool. Yeah, we do. We actually write down a lot of details and stuff like that, but we also allow to have meetings with people to imagine what was in our head when we were designing it, going along. And Jess described me as the repulsor. It's not hovering. It's not this dainty thing that's floating over the top of stuff. He imagined the repulsor plates as being this thing that punches the ground away from itself. You know, if it went up to a wall, it would smash the wall down. It wouldn't glide over the top of it. The Space Marines are brutal, so everything about them has to be brutal. Even the way they float is brutal. You know, so if you walked past a repulsor plate, you would feel it. You'd feel your chest cavity compressing. Mm. If it was like a room away, you'd feel the force of it, and you'd hear it, and you'd feel the ground shake with the power of it. And yeah, that's something we try and communicate as it goes down the line as well, because that's very much part of the design philosophy and language that we use going through. It's like Space Marines are brutal, so every version of what they have has to reflect that.
Yeah. So you've mentioned the design cues of some of the 40K factions, and we've talked about how Space Marines are offensive weapons and all their guises. Can you touch on some of the headlines for some of the other 40K factions?
Yeah, so they don't have like official headlines, but like usually when you're working on something, like for example, I was working on the Fire Prism, and Jess told me that the Eldar, it's an Eldar tank. Mm-hmm. So 50% of that is Eldar, which means it has to have these flowing shapes and it has to have all of these, you know, quite aesthetic aerodynamic qualities to it. But it's also a tank, because you can really go over the top with something. If you make everything completely out of just flowing lines and French curves and stuff like that, it doesn't look like a weapon. It doesn't look like a battlefield vehicle anymore. And yeah, it's a really fine balance to try and get all of that right. So yeah, it's stuff like that. With orcs, it's very important to make sure that something looks a bit ramshackle without looking broken. So there's a philosophy and a balance scale between that. How much do you damage something or make it out of bits of scrap before it just looks like a pile of scrap? Yeah. And it's something that it's not a written down thing. We don't have like a specific style guide for. But when you can see when it's right and when it's wrong. And a lot of the different factions have that. Mm-hmm. Chaos, for example, we've always had this scale between, you know, is it a man, is it a machine, is it a demon, and we sort of have a pointer that we put somewhere in that line. And we always have this thing where you push it as far as it'll go. So you have maybe on one scale it's a just turned to chaos vehicle, and the other side of it you've got a demon engine, and it's somewhere along there. There's going to be the sweet spot for it, and we've just got to find that balance by maybe pushing it too far and then just taking it back just a little bit. And that tends to be the best way of about finding this balancing point between everything we do.
Mm-hmm. The Chaos Knight, I remember you saying, has elements of some of the textures that you see in the Demon Engine. Not 100%, because that would make it a Demon Engine Knight, and that's not what you're going for. You're going for a corrupted knight that's clearly once was Imperial and has fallen to Chaos, but there's still room hypothetically to do something more elaborate and something like that down the line, I guess, because you've stated that that's the Chaos Knight at that point in its journey. So you've brought in elements of the Imperial Knight design, elements of the Chaos design to show where that Chaos Knight is on its journey. Mm. That's very recognisable.
Yeah, it's like we said about the trying to think of things in the future, that's exactly what we've done, so that when we do, if we do want to take it further, it's, if we do want to do a Demon Engine version of it, the current existing one isn't too far out of the realms of plausibility for that to happen. Mm. And it's all about that, trying to future-proof everything and trying to think about all the different versions of a thing that could exist. Mm.
What would you say are the main differences between like the Astra Militarum vehicles and the Space Marine ones?
The Astra Militarum is very much more traditional and old school in that, so we would reference stuff like World War II style era things, whereas Space Marines would be looking more towards modern stylings of any sort of military vehicle you can think of, and just to separate the two, because functionally they do kind of the same thing, but the character of the different armies is going to bring a certain aesthetic across.
Yeah. Would it be right to think that those features would appear in the mock-ups? If you were to work on Astra Militarum now, those would be manifest, and like if you were to work on the Imperial Knight now, you'd make sure the mock-up looked as heavy set and imposing as the final product would, because that's something that you need to communicate early on, I guess, isn't it? That's not just something that gets added in at the very end.
No, that's very much at the heart of everything we design, is like making sure that it fits in with the with the current stylings of a race. And sometimes you can get outliers and stuff like that. So when we did the Adeptus Mechanicus, we have a lot of very crazy biomechanical kind of things going on, like with the Iron Striders and the Servitor who's wired into it, and the quite upright designs and stuff like that. But then we also have the Castellan robots, which are more rounded and you know, don't really look like the rest of the stuff on purpose, because they're meant to come from pre-heresy era where everything was maybe different aesthetics and different shapes and stuff like that, and that's the way that we convey this is other to the rest of the range. So, you know, we also break the rules that we create as well, just to emphasize a difference in things like a Jakiro existing within.
So you said the orcs are a bit ramshackle. Had you worked on some of the newer vehicles that we've seen on that Speed Freaks game?
Yeah, I worked on the Hot Rod, the booster custom booster blaster that was on there, and that was a really great kit to work on, because I was working on the project with Dale, Matt, and Ed, and they're the biggest petrol heads in the office. They know about all of the vehicles. They know they can list different parts of the engine, and you know, they can all strip an engine down and rebuild it in their garages and stuff like that. So it was actually a lot of fun inhabiting their world, getting into the nuts and bolts of how stuff works. Because like I say, you've got to suspend that disbelief to make something that is a fantasy, ramshackle, post-apocalyptic vehicle. You have to learn about the combustion engine and how stuff fits together and what plugs into what where, so that you can break it apart and play and subvert the expectations and be like, oh, how would an orc rebuild this transaxle, for example? I need to know what a transaxle is, what it looks like, and what its function in a car is, so that I can pull that apart again. So working with guys who know a lot about that stuff and just taking reference and stuff like that is really interesting to kind of just build up an understanding of something so you can pull it apart again. And it's it's all like I said, the every project that we do is different and involves a different mindset change. So being able to inhabit something like that where other people have got all this knowledge about it, just being able to pick and take bits of their expertise to make what you're doing better is just a really interesting collaborative approach that we do to everything.
I guess working as part of the team that makes 40k stuff, you'll have been working on an awful lot of things that Jez Goodwin spent decades thinking of in a lot of cases. How's that?
Yeah, that is like working with Jez is crazy, because he's just got such a deep understanding of everything that he's working on. And you can see something on a sketch that he's drawn or on the model that you've made, and it's just a blip or a little tiny bit of detail or something, and he can talk to you about half an hour about what it is. He's just thought about absolutely everything that he's worked on, and it's really, really like just it levels you up just working with him, because you're getting this insight into the mind of 40k in a way, and it just really helps you understand that, because then you can take that on the next project that you're working on and just put your own emphasis and ideas into the similar sort of thing. Oh, he put something there that got across how they communicate, and you can think, well, our next kit that I'm going to do, I'm going to make sure that I'm going to put something in there that shows how they communicate. And it's just this great everyone building on everyone else's ideas and working methods and processes and stuff like that to make something more than the sum of its parts, really.
Have you worked on anything that has then come back round in the studio and then other designers have worked on, like a later iteration or a bolt-on new frame that goes with it or anything like that?
Yeah, I can't think of any that are out. I've got some coming up, definitely. Off the top of my head, I didn't work directly on it, but for example, the Baneblade came out, which was done while I was working in the rapid prototyping suite down there. And then years later, me and Dale worked on the Shadow Lord and Doomhammer and
Banehammer and Banesword
and all of that. Yeah. And we built upon something that we'd already made before, and that was a very surreal experience of sort of almost like archaeologically digging through the stuff that was already there to sort of remake it.
Did you find yourself cursing past you at any point?
Yeah, there's a couple of rivets that Dale was like, I wish they hadn't been there, it would have made our lives a whole lot easier. But you learn from it, and stuff like that happens less and less now, because we put specific fittings on stuff like the between the knights and make sure that we are using the same sizes and fittings and articulation points so they will be more cross compatible.
Yeah. People like that, I think. Yeah. People love that sort of stuff. So we've talked a bit about the Astra Militarum, the Space Marines, the Knights, the Adeptus Sororitas are another Imperial force, and Emperor willing, we understand they're coming later in 2019. We've certainly seen some of the new miniatures on the Warhammer community site, so I feel confident that we can talk about the existence of new miniatures. Yes. Have you been involved in that range at all?
The Sisters of Battle do exist.
Excellent.
I can confirm.
Fantastic.
Yeah. No, I have. I have worked on some Adeptus Sororitas vehicles.
Okay.
So I'm very excited for people to see more of that. I think little clips of them have been shown, but nothing solid as yet. But getting to revisit an old and favourite army like Sisters of Battle was a real pleasure to work on. And everybody who works on it was like really determined and focused on making it the best it could be. Mm. And there's a whole ton of research and background and reading and little details and stories and stuff hidden throughout the entire range. We've really gone to town with trying to make everything as diverse as possible in terms of background and what we're representing and everything like that. So I'm really excited to see when people get to see more of that.
There's definitely scope for an entire episode of VoxCast about that range and the people who worked on it, I think. As a kind of broad headline before we've seen too many of the details, how do you keep the designs for Adeptus Sororitas things distinct from the other Imperial units that you might be working on?
So a lot of it is historical, so looking back at the stuff that we've done in the past and boiling down the essence of what makes something what it was. And this happened with like the Primaris as well. Jez was spent a lot of time trying to find that balance point of like how much can you change something before it stops looking like the thing that it actually is. And we did exactly the same with Sisters of Battle. We got, here is a traditional one, here is just what a modern version of Sister would look like, and then pulled it as far away from the original image as possible before pulling it back and just making something that looked cohesive but different and varied and interesting as much as possible. So yeah, and this time we had the wealth of experience and like back catalogue of stuff that we've worked on to look at and to build upon, all of the standing on the shoulders of giants of people who've come before and of the stuff that we've done before, really. So
are there any ranges that you haven't had a chance to work on yet that you'd like to?
In 40K, I haven't worked on Gene Steel Cult yet, but I'd love to give them a shot. Yeah, I really like the aesthetic of their vehicles and that sort of mining, sort of gritty, quite industrial quality they have to them. Yeah,
there's a good bit of world building, I guess, in that you get to kind of show what civilian life in parts of the Imperium might be like. Doesn't have to be prescriptive and suggest everybody's got a Goliath rock grinder, but just the inclusion of the Goliath as a kind of utilitarian vehicle that would be around different parts of the Imperium. I think that's also a great little glimpse into the worlds of the 41st millennium that you can certainly show through what the Gene Stealer Cults go to war with, but you've also just let people know these are out there, that they're in the Imperium. So I for one would love to see what you get up to with the Gene Stealer Cults, because it would speak of the wider Imperium, I'm sure, as well.
Yeah, I mean, we actually did an exercise at the time while Gene Stealer Cult was coming out, that every designer sat down and made something that was Gene Stealer Cult related that wasn't necessarily a fighting unit. We just wanted to broaden everyone's perception of what the Gene Stealer Cult range could be, and just everything from like geologists and mechanics and stuff like that to strategists and everything in between, because we try and keep on our toes creatively, and that was just an exercise we did to help us, you know, everybody, even the people who weren't working on the range, just to flex our creative muscles a little bit and just to try and get under the skin of an army that was quite new and the aesthetic of what was going to be there. So yeah, we've all sort of had a little bit of our brains in that world already.
That's cool. And because I guess that's brand new, there wasn't anyone who'd have been making anything Gene Stealer Culty before Death Watch Overkill, so there's a great opportunity to make sure you don't leave any great ideas behind just because not everybody might have been associated with the project formally. Do you do that for other like releases, or if there is anything where you can't just go, we're making like the last versions but better, if you need to start with a completely blank piece of paper?
Done that with Age of Sigmar to try and fill out our understanding of what like normal humans would look like, and then we've just had just creative exercise of just if you could make anything that you possibly wanted to, just what would that look like?
Mm.
And we've we do lots of things like that just to try and break out of the box of maybe just laser focusing on one thing all the time, just to expand our like repertoire of ideas and get things out there that might not have got out there otherwise.
Mm.
And it's a really interesting and dynamic environment to be in, because somebody you didn't think of who wanted to make something suddenly comes out with this amazing thing, or like I didn't peg them as having wanted to have done that, or I didn't think he was into vehicles and he's obviously showing that he wants to do that, or I didn't think I was into monsters as much as I would be, or it's just a really great way of like just honing your skills and making sure that everyone's kind of kept interested and excited with everything that we're doing.
We talked to some of the heavy metal guys about Warcry a little while ago on Warhammer Live, and they were saying the heavy metal team was assembled together and they were just given some new models and said, paint them, what do you think? And that must be great fun when you're just completely freeform of what could this be, and inspiring other people with ideas that you haven't really conceived of before. That must be a good time.
Yeah, I mean, we've got such a range of different styles of things. We've got things that have been around for 30 years that are very, very nailed down of what they are exactly, and every pip and every detail and every marking has maybe a book written about it, and you know, the bestiary where you can go in and find every detail about everything. But we've equally got things that are completely brand new and unheard of before, and they both have to coexist within the same universe. So it's it's actually quite a broad range of responsibilities for each and every project that we do.
Mm. We do have huge responsibility, really, because like as you said, you are the first point of contact with new ideas, really, because they'll be made as miniatures first, and then they might be written about in books or in Black Library publications, but only if the people understand what was in your head and you've made it and put it on the table. So it's a huge responsibility, because if that's not really grokked or picked up by other bits of Games Workshop, it won't be shown to the people who want to see it and want to know that it's cool.
Yeah, and I think that's where the benefit is of us being around for so long, just working on the same stuff, being here for 13 years, sitting with people like Ali who have been here for 30 years, all working on the same thing still, is we're just, we're constantly building on our strengths and trying our best to be better every single time. So it's a big responsibility, but also we've got a lot of background. A lot of the time we're not just going to something completely not knowing what it is. It's a collaborative approach, so you've got the guy over there who invented the thing that you're working on just working right there, and you've got the people who've written all the books about them just around the corner. So it's a huge responsibility, but we're surrounded by people who are great at all aspects of these sorts of things, so we never feel adrift for ideas or anything like that. It's always it's a great collaborative approach, and it's always great seeing what someone else's spin on something. You go take something to show somebody, take a mock-up and say, what do you think about this? They come up with 10 different ideas. You come to someone else, they've got another 10 ideas, and it's just like, wow.
It feels like a particularly exciting time at the moment as well, because I think Death Watch Overkill, that board game with Death Watch Kill Team, Gene Stealer Cultists that we hadn't really seen before, there was a kind of stirring in people of my sort of age, mid-late 30s, remembering the Gene Stealer Cultist miniatures, the Gene Stealer hybrids of the Citadel catalogues of the early 90s. And then nearly 20 years later, these same ideas are represented to us, but they're mind-blowing in scope. Like, the miniatures are incredible compared to even my rosy-tinted memories of what 1991 Citadel catalogue miniatures look like. But it's not just, here's everything you remember, made better, off you go. There's always brand new stuff, like what you're talking about with the Gene Stealer Cultists, getting strategists and gunfighters and freedom fighter kind of characters. It's not just make the fighter archetype, make the wizard archetype. Like, it is honest and appropriate to each range of miniatures, each faction. But yeah, you see things that you just wouldn't even imagine. And it's the same with kind of Necromunda and the other different studios. You get all the gangs you remember from the 90s and the hired guns and all the other crazy miniatures that definitely exist. Of course they exist. When you start to think about it, of course they exist, but we hadn't seen them before, so we didn't know to demand them from the people making the new iterations. And I think that's something we see with all the miniatures designers. Yeah. You see improved versions of things that you remember and things you never saw coming at all whatsoever, and that's always really exciting to be on the receiving end of.
Yeah, it's really interesting because we look backwards as much as we look forward. So sometimes when I work on stuff, I'm looking back at an image or a drawing from that second edition of 40K book that I first got me into the hobby to help me realize what a kit that's going to be coming out in 2 years is going to look like. And it's such a weird sort of cyclical approach, because you've got just a huge range of like inspiration from stuff that's back in the past or stuff that's going to be created in the future that you can pull from. And yeah, those, like I said, those sketches and drawings, those Jez Goodwin sketches or the John Blanche drawings from the second edition books that you got in the box, it's still used to give us reference or ideas or inspiration for things that are going to come out in the future.
And then hobbyists get hold of them and do stuff that no one's ever imagined whatsoever. Have there been any big surprises, or is there anything particularly inspiring that you've seen anyone attempt with anything you've designed?
Nothing specifically, but I worked on something recently where I looked at just something that somebody had done, and it just sparked off something in my head. And it wasn't like, it was just like, sometimes you'll represent something and they but you'll be like, well, obviously something comes out of here, but you haven't modeled it, you haven't had the space, that's not the remit of what that project was. And then someone shows like maybe a vehicle just with people hanging off it, or you know, being used in a way that you had thought of, but you hadn't seen it represented. And you're like, ah, that's how I imagined that would work. Yeah. So it's great to see that, really.
Bit of vindication.
Yeah,
yeah, vindication. Definitely makes sense. Yeah. Class. Well, I think we're pretty much out of time. So I'm going to thank you again for coming along and sharing the benefits of your 13 years of designing awesome Citadel miniatures. And I'm looking forward to whatever you must have been designing that's going to come out in the next couple of years.
Because
it'll be a while before we see it. Thank you very much, Tom. We'll see you again soon.
Thanks, Wade. Cheers.
Thanks again to Tom, and thank you for watching or listening to the podcast. VoxCast will return in 2 weeks' time, and there'll be another episode of Stormcast released next week. In the meantime, you can keep up to date with details of all the programmes we're making, and leave us any feedback you have about any of the podcasts on the Warhammer TV Facebook page. See you soon.